I think you'll agree it's been extremely interesting to hear everyone's different points of view, and hopefully I won't repeat what things have been said already. My name is Victoria Raiment, and I sit within the Flood Risk and Transport Asset Management team of Derbyshire County Council. James, my line manager, will be presenting the aspect from the Local Planning Authority. So, in Derbyshire, we've got 10 local planning authorities. So, from South Derbyshire, District Council, the River Trent floodplains in the south, right up to the High Peak Borough Council in the northwest. We've also got the Peak District National Park, who are also a planning authority. And also, Chesterfield Borough Council, our largest urban conurbation in Derbyshire, outside of Derby City. So, I'll try not to teach everyone to suck eggs, but across Derbyshire, in our 10 local planning authority areas, each one has a different local plan and different ideas about how flood risk should be managed. And each one has, refers to a different strategic project assessment for planning, strategic planning across each borough or district. And as we've identified, they're heavily based on fluvial. So, moving forward, this picture illustrates that the local planners don't really know who we are, and we are a local planning. We are the local planning authority with a lot of information that they don't have. And as you can see, this is a planning place in Derbyshire, a planning development that doesn't really encompass sense of what we want to do in the future. And I think really it's a real challenge for us to work across 10 different local planning areas to implement SuDs. And really it's at their discretion what they include in any future policies or plans. So Derbyshire, we've become the LFA, and obviously we thought that we would become the SAP. So we began by deciding to respond to planning applications as a non-statutory consultee in a similar way to FADED. We provided river information, water course, historic information, groundwater, and also potentially some highway flooding issues, and also building into that WFD aspect. We also undertook some in-house SAP training, and we met with Syria, and we also had some consultants come in and give some information about what we might need to be thinking about. We began to draft our local standards, so we thought about possibly the idea of linking it into local plans at the district borough level, possible SPD. We had discussions with our internal team, so the planners, our county planners, and also the heritage teams, and numerous of the teams within the county. We also had discussions with risk management authorities all across Derbyshire, our technical officers flood risk group, and we broached and we had a lot of debate about the pros and cons of SuDs and SAP. But most importantly, we began to strengthen our engagement with the LPAs. So we actually went across the county and we held SAP road shows, as we called them. We introduced ourselves, as we go back to that picture earlier on. They didn't know who we were, they didn't know what we did. So really it was a first stepping stone into helping improve the situation across Derbyshire. So we talked about what SAP might entail, what Schedule 3 had in plan for us. We talked about SuDs and how quashing some of the rumours about them being too expensive in all aspects. Obviously, covering the whole aspect of SuDs and trying not to focus too heavily on about amenity, but also the benefits of other aspects of SuDs. We also talked about adoption and maintenance and the importance of thinking about the future. And it allowed us to have a discussion about key concerns. So what this led to was an increase in engagement from the LPAs and coming to us for information. So I mentioned earlier that we began to have a bit of a drip feed of information or request for information from the planner, sorry. And this actually substantially increased twofold over a very, very short period. And bear in mind, this is a non-statutory function. However, we we agreed that it was in our best interest as a lead local flood authority, because we wanted to think about possible impacts of not getting involved now, how that might impact on our role as statutory function moving forward. So it began to look very unlikely in 2014 that Shadow Flea wasn't going to become enacted. So we've been talking about the SAD for a long time, and then it wasn't. And we were consulted by DEFRA in January of this year, where we thought we were going to be the surface water statutory consultancy only. And that obviously there was major concerns, you know, that there's a massive loophole in we're not rethinking our water course and groundwater, we're already kind of doing it, but providing response to planners, but then as a statutory function, how that is a particular concern of the county, because everything we do, it costs money, and we are constantly trying to refine our level of service, which is based around statutory function. So going back to that, we began preparing, which was a continuation really, for our possible statutory consultee role. So we actually met with our environment agency colleagues, and we talked about possibly having a planning buddy. Now I know, Bronwyn, you mentioned that the environment agency actually sat with their team. We unfortunately haven't been offered that, and we've actually got four environment agency officers covering Derbyshire, and each one has a different idea of how they were going to act as such a consultee for them moving forward. We also decided it would be a good idea to go to the local planning authority and have a little workshop and over the table discussion, which James hopefully will cover in a bit more detail. We also work very closely with cross-border authorities, Staffordshire County Council, and we also form part of the South Yorkshire group. And I know Roger's here from Sheffield today. We've worked with them on producing the interim local guidance for sustainable drainage systems. So this is a local standards interim document that they've been working on for a while. So we've been working on helping them produce that. And that forms the basis of our drafting local standards, which we're currently producing. And our local standards currently have checklists for developers, and trying to make it easy really for them to how to focus their development, and not being too detailed, saying what we want and what we envisage is a good idea last year, rather than having all the statutory stuff and all the waffle at the front. So on the 15th of April we became statutory consultee. So we as a statutory consultee we've continued to engage with the local planning authorities. We've discussed the EA updated position, which, as I mentioned earlier, differs greatly across the county, which adds another level of complexity at a two-tier level. So not only are we're confused what some particular areas have, but also local planners, they don't know which particular area, how they're going to respond, which means there's a bit of an overlap in terms of who's commenting on what. It's become very confusing for the RPAs. We talked about what our level of service would be moving forward and what we would provide as a statutory consultee. So previously we looked at Water Framework Directive, we talked about the water courses, historical information, groundwater, BGS data, and now we're saying as a statutory consultee our main focus will be surface water. We also looked at possible conditions which previously, some planners had utilised our generic comments that were very high level and created conditions based on those comments. So we talked about how that, obviously, we wouldn't be able to discharge conditions that we've not been involved in. There's a possibility now, though, that we would be able to help create conditions and be involved in helping them decide to discharge those conditions. We've also created a matrix which we have shared with the local planning authorities. This allows them to decide when and where to contact us and request us to provide guidance as a statutory consultee. This particular matrix has also helps the team focus their level of response to a particular planning application. I'd just like to note that if in this instance, if at any point goes into the red box, on any of those white boxes down the left hand side, then that would trigger a red assessment, which is a full assessment, which is going to come here. So if no development is given standing advice, which is predominantly based around what we previously gave them, standing advice could cover things like, for example, in the northeast of the region where the old mining towns, in reference to that, there might be adits and stuffs across the site that they might not be aware of, water framework generic comments, and also surface water generic comments, but always tying back to the non-technical non-technical standards. And this, for the amber development, it's a slightly more tweaked version of that, with major key concerns at the top and possibly breaking into potentially discharge or condition suggestion. And then our detailed red assessment. This is predominantly based around suggestions for conditions as part of the planning application. And then at each stage, the officer, we've also created what's called a checklist, so that each the officer can, what they're looking out for within the planning application. So I mean, Faye covered a lot of the things that we're looking out for, very, very similar to ourselves, predominantly, again, based around the non-technical standards. So just a few statistics for you. Since becoming the statutory consultee, we've received 30. We thought that's about one a day. We thought we'd get about two a day. So it appears not so bad. However, in terms of our level of service or what we've been asked to comment on, we're still being asked to comment on the ones prior to the 15th of April. We've still got people coming in. We're still being, in some instances, they're not using the matrix right. So again, the challenge for ourselves to try and deal with, that we're looking at extensions to garages that are in very, very lonely zones. And also, as I mentioned earlier, we're also having lots of quite not heated, but disagreements with local planning authorities that are saying to us, well, you gave us this advice pre-15, will you help us discharge this condition? And obviously, we weren't such a consultee. The advice was given to them to help inform them. We weren't involved in creating that condition. So it's just speaking between legal departments and getting that agreement. And that then pass over to James.
Great, thank you, Dan. What I'm going to try and do now, we'll talk about wearing multiple hats. I'm a civil engineer by trade, and I'm going to hopefully portray the view of one of our local planning authorities, so I'm going to attempt to be a planner for the next 5 minutes or so, on sharing with you, as Tor's kind of alluded to, what we've been doing in the two-tier setting to set processes and policies in place. But what does that mean at the local level, and how and where have we come with engagement for doing that? So, first thing we did was, and just identifying one of our planning authorities, is we thought, as and Faye also alluded to it earlier, the skills gap, or the knowledge and the need for expanding our knowledge is on two sides, whether that be civils or whether that be planning. So we said to South Derbyshire Council, would you mind having us for the day to, obviously not teach us to be a planner, it takes a lot longer than a day, I appreciate that, but to share with us, okay, we're going to deliver this service, but what do you expect from us? What do we need? What sort of things should we need to know? What should we be considering to help you make informed decisions for sustainable development? So they kindly hosted that, and it allowed for that dialogue, a two-way dialogue. It again strengthened relationships, face-to-face discussion and dialogue, getting to know the team. Again, although we sit in a two-tier setting, it's still a relatively small team, and we're constantly evolving. And just picking up on the points made earlier by Bronwyn, we didn't, during the non-statutory phase of our time, we were just up against so many other pressures that we literally have started from the beginning. So it's not the massive flick of the switch of the 50th of April, but prior to that, it wasn't an enhanced level of service, so we are slowly trying to pick that up. There still exists within the discussion with the local planning authorities a confusion over roles and remits with the EA, and I think, because Tor alluded to, we have four different EA offices with different PSO offices commenting on planning. There's different views, different approaches, and trying to pick up the legacy of what's been done there. And that's confusing the planners somewhat. But also, where there's a fluvial-pluvial impact, and we are both being consulted on our application, how do we get that synergy and that response that makes sense to the planners? So that's still a challenge, I'm still working on that. Levels of service, SAB versus consultee. Not that it's such a fight, but the reality of it is, myself and Tor went all over doing these SAB roadshows saying one thing, and now when we refer to SAB, it's like the elephant in the room, but it's the difficulty around that. We talk about building these relationships and engagements, normally when they turn up, I think I'm telling porkies, because, well, where's this SAB? And, well, surely the two-tier, you'll be maintaining these features. So that's been difficult, agreeing and understanding levels of service. Again, levels of service is what the planners would like from us. What, again, alluding to the fact that they confess not to be experts, and that maybe we can deliver that service, but can we? And to what level? And how is it funded? So those challenges still exist. And unfortunately, I'm not going to answer, but just to reassure you, we're all in the same boat. Support, and then support needed from the LLFA. Again, we've been fortunate in terms of resource. We were a team of five, but it's soon to become a team of seven, covering all of the county area. But again, as failure to, if we're responding to our other statutory duties, we've got such a level of service to deliver anyway, and the planning is just another section to that. So, putting in the mindset of the local planning authorities, we've had these discussions with them and think about, oh yes, through statutory consultation, providing information, but they're under extreme pressure in their own right with so many other material considerations that they have to think about. And also, the skill base at the local level. I think there was a question earlier about the resources in the district boroughs within the two-tier setting. We have, within the eight district borough authorities, there is one authority for whom have an external service with Kier, and then the others have, South Derbyshire have one municipal engineer. I say municipal because he does everything. Car parks, Christmas lighting, and SuDs, bless him. And so, just to put into context, the pressure that he's got at a local level, and then the others don't have any drainage experience whatsoever. So, the shout from the local planning authorities, LLFA, please help. What we're trying to remove from, and what the local planning authority are concerned about, and Tor alluded to, is a matrix. To step away from standard advice, they want, wherever possible, to be covered by specific issues, specific comments to inform the development. And again, the confusion over this transitional period, we had that little chart of about 30 applications. In reality, we've been dealing with around 40, 50, based on the fact that we're still picking up the transition coming into this new phase. Another issue and challenge we're looking at is conditions and the strength of conditions. And when we were a non-statutory consultee, one of the things we were really worried about is, I'm not a strong believer of sitting on a fence, but nor did I want to jump off it. And it's not that we're risk averse, but it's if we're going to share with these conditions, are they defendable? Are they enforceable, reasonable and precise? And we have that air of confidence at that stage. Although we're a statutory consultee now, I've not got the air of confidence, and it's continuing to evolve, and sharing a good practice is critical in doing that. So we've got the national policy, the local plan and the SPDs. In a two-tier setting, again, as Tor alluded to, the local plans within our county, now they're at all different stages, and trying to now embed this into policy is quite difficult. There are some of the LPs who engaged with through the SAB roadshow did take it on board that something was going to change, and they have monitored it, and we've had that direct dialogue. And one of our district authorities do have SUDs within the local plan, and hopefully going to move towards an SPD approach as well. There's no local design guides yet, and what one of our district borough authorities is doing though is out of the nine LPs, sorry, excluding us as a minerals and waste, they are now adopting SUDs features at the district level. Now, what they're finding is though, it is beyond critical to have input at the design stage, but although having that input, have they got the right people appraising said design is the question. And I go back to the gentleman who's the municipal engineer. That's another meeting he's got to go to. Another thing that we're talking with the district plans about, and looking at the DC planning and the policy planning, is the fact around when we look at sequential testing and SFRAs and the like, there's still that it's heavily labelled around fluvial flood risk, and we need to change the mindset of the plans in terms of the other forms of local flood risk, and how they link and the interlinks between them. Also, I know it may come as a shock to some of the audience today, but the dialogue with the planners about just explaining the role of the LFA, although it's been some time, it hasn't, the engagement hasn't been that easy to embed that into that. And we're still trying to achieve that. The other thing is embedding the SuDs into the vision for future plans. So we've got here, I alluded to South Derbyshire earlier, they've now got the part 1-2 of the local plan, relatively updated 2014 and embed to SuDs. But then we look at other current SPD documents that are dated around 2007, and again, the authorities are at different phases. And how we, if we try to sort of support the LPAs in writing an SPD, will they all adopt it? Does it tick 10 different boxes with different priorities and different pressures? So looking at the discussion on the adoptions, I alluded to one of the aids of the planning authorities are now adopting, and they are doing so through the 106 agreements. And what they have found is that the big question mark or concern they have is over the maintenance liabilities of it, the cost of maintenance, commuted sums, or maintenance contributions over the life of the assets. They're looking at a 25-year maintenance period for the SuDs features. I can't break it down for you. That's a global figure for features at that time. They're trying to promote the 106 approach because there's a bit of concern about how developers feel about maintenance companies and the capital costs needed. And maybe if they go for this more maintenance contribution approach, would it be easier to adopt through the 106? What they're looking at is between £1,200 and £1,500 the dwelling currently as a charging mechanism for those features. I've got to heavily caveat it though, because it is still a learning curve. They're not confessing to have all the answers or that is the right evaluation and how they should go about it, but they're trying to start somewhere because they want the development, need the development in that area. The officers' costs are still being evaluated on a case-by-case basis. So we talk about fee charging. They've not got a structured fee charge. It's based on size of development, complexity of development. Poor old municipal engineer will get there again somewhere. The adoption impacts and the resource. One of the questions I had with the local planners was, okay, you said you want to be heavily involved in the design, but when it comes to the build, i.e. it's on the ground and you're going to adopt it, who's going to inspect it? Won't come to any shop. It's a municipal engineer. He'll be there again. there must be 10 of them. But no, all joking aside, himself and a landscape architect within the authority are going to be the clerk of works. So again, we need to see how it goes, but they are trying and it needs to be evaluated and evolved. And they are, even though they're going through this approach, they are not looking to have fee charging for pre-application. Again, around need for housing, development, economic generation growth, they've decided not to have fee charge pre-app. So really, all in all, hopefully that should give an overview of some of our RPA sits and the complexities that they're going through. Just to hopefully bring to a close now, what is on our to-do list as we move forward? We need to embed and have those discussions with our local plan authorities in terms of amendments to, updates to local plans or SFRAs, or just get SuDs in there and into one of the key considerations. Although we've got the MPPF, the wording of such, to give it a bit more strength and link to conditions. We are engaging with our internal planning authorities in minerals and waste, and we're going to look at SFRA level 2 for our mineral waste, and look at, as failure to check the wording and do a bit of a review of SFRAs with our planning authorities if they need to update rewording. Adoption possibly of local standards for SPD for all 10 LPAs. How would that go? How would we design such a thing? And it was nice to hear of some good practice already out there. Again, we've not got to reinvent the wheel, so thank you for that. And constantly evaluating the impact of resource. We've spoken about it, but the levels of service, what resource is needed, how do we deliver an informed service for our partners? So in a nutshell, we need to continue to engage, continue to develop, because we have had a bit of a flick of the switch on the 15th of April, and therefore evolve and learn together because even in a two-tier setting, we're in it together. There's a lot of complexities behind it, but the common goal is we want sustainable development in Derbyshire.